This morning, there's a real clear connection between the cost of housing and the cost of transportation. Where you live and whether or not you have access to transportation to get to where you need to get to, whether it's to a job or to health care or to wherever, to school or wherever. And so this panel deals with equity issues as it relates to, as I said before, transportation and housing. We have four panelists, and there are the presenters, and in the program you can see the bios. I'll just give short introductions. The first panelist is Dr. Sarmitha Rena Majumdar, who is assistant professor in the school of in our School of Public Affairs and in the Department of Political Science and Public Administration, and she has worked, done a lot of work dealing with public administration, transportation, and management, and we are really glad that she joined us last year as an assistant professor, and she will be presenting the paper that's co-authored with Dr. Ben Johnson and myself, and so she'll present that today. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bullitt. And as Dr. Bullitt mentioned, that I do research on transportation. This is the first time that I'm looking at the inequity issues under the guidance and encouragement of Dr. Bullitt and Johnson, and also another esteemed team member, Dr. Sen. I just want to discuss about some of the existing inequities in public transportation in the city of Houston. And my presentation will be mainly in the form of graphs and data, because a picture is worth a thousand words, and I'm going to show you some of the existing inequities in transportation in the city of Houston. Okay, so let's start with the first slide, and let's look at the transit services provided by the Houston Metro. As we all know, it was established in 1979, and it provides us with the bus service, with the light rail service, and then there is the metro lift service, the van pool, and of course, you know, the motorist assistant program or the MAP program. Now, when it comes to the operating cost of Houston public transit services, you will see that it has the second largest service area in comparison with other major metropolitan cities of the nation. The largest service area is that of Los Angeles, followed by that of Houston. But if you look at the funding, and you will see that 66% of the funding is derived from local sources. This is the highest number when it comes to local funding among all the major public transit systems in different metropolitan areas. And look at the state fund, it's zero when it comes to operating costs. So the state does fund, you know, capital expenditures, but not none of that money comes towards the operating expense, unlike in other cities. And also it receives the second largest federal assistance after Los Angeles. So as a result of that, you know, because of the funding issues, and its budget is actually one of the lowest, its operating expense is one of the lowest in comparison with other large cities in the nation. So that gives us some idea of where, you know, like some of these inequities rest on. Now let's look at the operating expense per bus passenger mile, and we see that Los Angeles has the lowest, and after that it's Houston. And maybe one of the reason is Los Angeles having that the lowest is it has a larger service area, more passengers, etc. So when you spread the cost over a larger population, of course, you know, your cost is going to go down, whereas the Houston's ranking in terms of ridership is comparatively low, but it's still kind of low, which is only like 0.77 or 77 cents per bus passenger mile. Now, when it comes to transit, you know, like ownership of vehicles, I looked at the the zero vehicle ownership rate in major cities, and you will see that Houston has the lowest figure. It is kind of like 4.2%. And what does this suggest? That there is greater dependence on automobile in this city. Whereas in New York and in Washington, D.C., they have the largest zero vehicle ownership rate, which tells you that there is more dependence on public transit system in this city. So as a result of the inequities and the lack of public transit facilities, more people are compelled to rely on public on their own personal vehicles. And also, it's also a part of the state culture. We have a very strong car culture in the state, so that also needs to be partly addressed in order to make public transit being used more by people in this city. Now, what about the public transit ridership ranked by unlinked passenger trips? We find that, again, our city once again ranks 28th in the nation. So we lag behind among the other major metropolitan areas. And in proportion to metro population, well, we are 7th in the nation. So again, you know, as you can see from that statistics, we need to address that problem. We need to make people make greater use of public transit and also improve our public transit in the city. Now, looking at the Houston Metro Survey, I found out that people use public transit for various purposes, but it's mainly for work that they use, and they usually ride the metro bus or they park and ride. And if you look at the racial composition of Houston metro ridership, you will see that the whites, they make greater use of park and ride facilities, while the blacks, they make greater use of metro bus services, and the Hispanic and Latino community also make greater use of the metro bus service and less of the metro ride. And the, you know, like, and again, you know, there's a reversal in the trend. In the Asian population, they also tend to make greater use of park and ride and less use of the metro service. Now, what about the household income of metro and park and ride patrons? So you will find that the people who ride the metro bus, they usually have an income below 16,000. And also, if you look at the range from below 16 to 32K, you will see that the larger number of bus riders are the lower income people. This is nothing new, but you know, this again, the statistics tries to convince the fact that we need to address the transportation needs of the lower income people, because they are the one, you know, like, whose needs are neglected in planning for transportation. Now, what about the household vehicles of Houston metro riders? We see that when it comes to local unlinked trips, which are usually, you know, availed by the minority population, the largest percentage with zero vehicles is close to 45%. And the metro park and riders, just look at that percentage. It is less than 1% of the metro park, I mean the park and ride patrons who have zero vehicles. Now, what about the age profile of the Houston metro riders? If you look at the unlinked trips age profile, we find that people who are in the age range of, I would say, 14 to 70, they make a greater use of the metro bus services compared to other age groups. And you know, when it comes to the commuting cost burden, let's see what how does Houston fare in comparison with other large metropolitan cities of the nation. Let's look at the working poor and the other household statistics, and you will see that the working poor, look at the number of the working poor in the Houston and their expenditure on transportation commuting costs. It is far higher in comparison with New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, Atlanta, Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, and Boston. And again, you know, I will show you some other interesting statistics which would partly help to explain the reason why. Now, let's look at the commuting and the housing cost burden, and you will see that Houston lies in a quadrant where the commuting cost is kind of high, but it's not like above the median. Okay, and also for the households, for the working poor households, which is the first graph over here, this is where Houston is. Now, when you look at the other households' cost of burden, again, you know, we see that Houston lies in this quadrant, which is, again, you know, like a higher commuting cost, but not so much of a higher housing cost. When it comes to the share of the lower income households residing in majority lower income census tract, we find, again, look at the statistics, that 37% of the people, of the lower income people, they live in the lower income tracts. Well, you know, we see that in New York, this is 41%, and in Philadelphia, it's 38%. So Houston is kind of like ranked third in the nation with more lower income people living in the lower income tracts. And then, you know, compared to that, let's look at the upper income households residing in majority of the upper income census tract. Again, you will see that Houston ranks as the first in the nation, like 24% of the upper income group live in the higher income areas. Now, what does this all tell us? Again, Houston has the highest ranking when it comes to the residential income segregation index. This index is formed by, you know, like adding the lower income groups and the higher income groups. And higher the index, it implies that there is a lower or a shrinking middle income class in the city area, and more people have, and again, one of the reasons why Houston tops this list is because more people in the two categories, that is the lower income and the higher income people, have moved into the Houston and the Dallas metropolitan area. So that is one of the reasons why Houston has the highest index of 61, which is a change by 29, and that's quite a number. Now, job accessibility time taken, we find that, again, you know, Houston is over here with that red dot, and it says that 27.5% to 30.9% of the jobs are accessible, and it takes by transit, and it takes about 90 minutes. Again, you know, to get a better picture, we can see that where Houston ranks. So in Houston, we find that, again, 30% of the, or slightly below 30% of the jobs are accessible by public transit in 90 minutes. And this is just, again, you know, a map of the United States where you see the larger cities. And if you look at the Houston areas, again, travel time in minutes by county or equivalent is 30 or more in this Houston area. Again, let's look at the job sprawl index of Houston, and you would see that this number is very disappointing. 57.2% of the jobs lie between 10 and 35 miles from the CBD. So what happens is that, you know, more people have need this public transit to go to work, and right now, you know, with the AGAC plans on investing more in park and ride facilities, which sounds very good because we need to cut back on air pollution and ease congestion, but it does not address the needs of the minority groups living in the city, mainly the blacks and the Hispanics. So there is this job sprawl index. I don't know how much time I have. Let's look at this job sprawl index by race. And if you look at this index, you will see that when it comes to the whites, you will see that these dots over here are lying close to this line over here. But when it comes to blacks, it's more spread out. So this is a serious problem over here, that blacks have to travel a longer distance to work. And by providing park and ride facilities or by emphasizing more on its development is not going to help the blacks and the Hispanics and the Asians living in the Houston areas, because most of the low-skilled jobs lie in the CBD or within the city limits and not in the suburbs. So, you know, it doesn't make any sense to them. So we need to address the needs of the minority population. And again, you know, this is again blacks and the Latinos comparison over here. And again, once again, we see, you know, there is a greater sprawl among the black community than again in comparison with that of the Latino community. Just, you know, the job sprawl index of Houston in comparison with other large metropolitan areas, it's pretty high. And, you know, because I don't have much time, I just want to show you something else. What are the other alternative modes of transportation to work? And you will see that in this, only 19 metro areas do more than 25% of commuters travel to work by a mode other than driving alone. And where does Houston stand? It stands nowhere. Only what we see is Austin, Texas, where we see that the yellow one is a large portion of its working population, they carpool. Then the gray area is the transit. The red part is the work at home. Then, you know, the gray area, the darker gray is the bike, walk, and then other. So again, once again, where does Houston stand in comparison with other metropolitan cities of the nation? And look at this. This figure is pretty dismal over here. The yellow areas represent the transit proportion of transit users. The walk area is the blue area, and the green area is the bike. So again, alternative modes of transit are very poorly developed in the Houston area, and all these needs need to be addressed. So what are the, you know, like based on the evidences that I've provided you, what are the implications of this? That we need to understand the social and the travel behavior of the minority population in order to make the city more accessible by public transit, because otherwise, you know, the inequities that exist in income and in residential areas is going to expand, and it's, and we need to put a stop to that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're really lucky to get this young professor. Our next panelist speaker is Dr. Carol Lewis, my friend, colleague that I've known for many years, professor in the Department of Transportation, and she will present looking at transit-oriented development and exploring new opportunities here in Houston. And I might add that Dr. Lewis also was director of planning at Metro for a number of years. Dr. Lewis.
Thank you. So while we're getting the slides up, I thank Dr. Manjandara for the presentation, and obviously had many, many thoughts about the data she showed. There are a lot of reasons for what happened, but I think as a bottom line, it challenges all of us in terms of making advances and trying to do more. So I'm going to talk today in line with our theme, the Invisible Houston, and I thank Dr. Bullard and his faculty and team for bringing this forum together, for us having the opportunity to talk about this and revisit what's gone on in our city about the last 30 years. I'm going to kind of focus on how the transportation infrastructure puts pressure on black and low-income communities, and particularly how this emerging idea of transit-oriented development is going to potentially affect us, and again, what we need to be aware of and consider and make sure that we have our sort of finger on the pulse of what's going on in our communities. I know through the course of the day you've heard a lot about the demographic changes, and that foundation has been laid about where we live, where we work, how we're moving. 30 years ago, the African American community in Houston was sort of focused on the core areas, you know, sort of northeast, a little bit northwest, and then inner south, southeast. Over the years, as the highways were constructed, and I think in Invisible Houston, the first document, Dr. Bullard writes about the fact that those freeways, I-10, I-45 cut in a mighty way into what was the black community. And then lastly, in the 1970s, that might have been 30 years ago too, but State Highway 288, when I first moved to Houston, Highway 288 was being constructed, and it was just unbelievable how massive the land area that was taken to build 288. And so what that did is it moved African-American pockets of individuals and forced migration really to the outer suburbs. And we've talked about that land, they've called it land, and you know that suburban migration that we've seen. And so what happened then was we saw the highway department doing it, and I'm going to talk about the potential for transit to have a very similar effect. So we have this transit-oriented development, and it's a contemporary emphasis on an idea that reminds us of the old-timey neighborhood. And anymore, there's not necessarily the same pressure or desire for people to live in suburbs. There's a new invigoration of people to live in urban areas, of them to be in walkable, what we call mixed-use communities. And you might remember if you saw a movie long ago in the 1950s where there would be a shop owner on the ground floor and people would live upstairs above the shop. Well, that whole concept is coming back and gaining in the thought that that's a really positive thing to do. It shortens trip lengths. It shortens our time to get places. It gives us more time to spend with our families. And a part of that is that it's very transit friendly. You know, you want transit in the mix of it, and you want to be able to walk to transit. You want the transit to be frequent. You want it to be fast. The other thing is that it's got the sustainable element of being bike friendly, and again, pedestrian friendly. And so I'm going to talk a bit about how our black community, particularly in Houston, is going to relate to what we talk about with this TOD. Now, a lot of you may have seen other terms, and there are a lot of terms when we talk about transit-oriented development. You might hear it called smart growth. You might hear it called a transit village. Lots of conversation about mixed-use development. The point and thing that they all have in common is increased density, that they're walkable, and that they are, in theory, supposed to have a mix of income and housing types. So they're not, in theory, supposed to be designed just to be for upper income individuals. In practice, when you look at them around the country, they normally are. Now the other thing I'm going to add there is that there are some town centers that we have in our suburbs. You know, the Woodlands got one, and Sugarland's got one, and Pearland's got one. Well, what about those? Well, when you look at them, they have a lot of the elements of smart growth, but the issue with them is that the majority of people have to drive to them. And so they kind of violate the entirety of the concept, because you can't really take transit to get to them. Now, what's good about them, though, is that at least they form a core and a foundation, and they're designed in that way. So if in the future the transit develops that way, at least they can transition. And so that, in contrast to some of the suburban neighborhoods that are developed on a curvilinear street that you can't get out of, and so you could never come in and really make it walkable. You could never come in and make it transit friendly. And we've seen in Northwest Houston how, and I'm kind of a little bit off subject here, but I'm going to get back in just a minute, how that kind of development adds so much to our costs in our urban areas. Because when you have that kind of development, even the school districts can't get from the neighborhood right here to the neighborhood right there, because you have to go out to a major street. It adds tremendous miles and hours and all kinds of inconveniences to everyone's trip. So that's just an admonition against that kind of development and for the kind of development that we talk about in transit-oriented development. We just talked a minute ago and just heard about cost of moving around, cost for transportation. I'm going to show another way of looking at that housing and transportation trade-off. And so what we see here is an adding of transportation cost and housing cost as a total affordability. And so what that's doing is showing how much / little income remains for discretionary spending. So when you get to the Houston column here, you see that we spend 56% of our income, and this is for people who make between $20,000 and $50,000 a year. So those families are spending, again, roughly 56% of their income on their housing and transportation. The highest city actually is Los Angeles at 59%, but the point of that is if you're in that income category, we kind of want to start really changing your paradigm and getting you to think about, can I maybe pay a little bit more for my housing, perhaps by being in one of these transit-oriented development sort of mixed-use areas, and lower my transportation costs. Maybe I could eliminate the need to have a car if I were to live in one of these kinds of areas. Again, for us, it's a paradigm shift, but it's something that we want to start thinking about. So looking at our opportunity to do this in Houston and what we're actually seen in terms of our population and our concentrations of populations. And again, I think you've probably seen this statistic presented a number of ways today. But largely, if we look at the African American population in the city of Houston in 1980 compared to 2010, we've seen an 11% increase in African Americans who live in the city of Houston. That compares to a 32% increase in the city of Houston population as a whole. Bottom line, as a percentage of the entire population within the city, we are shrinking. Our population is diminishing. And that just shows the absolute number. All right, so now I want to talk about our opportunities for transit-oriented development around Houston's light rail systems. So if we look at the map that we see here, the line in purple is the southeast. Oh, good grief. All right. I'm sure there was a better way for me to do it, but I don't know what it was. All right. All right, and since I don't really know exactly what I did that made the slide advance, I hope I don't do it again. But this is the purple line that leads downtown, comes east, and then moves down Scott Street, essentially to where we are right now. So when we look at the concentrations of African-American communities on the map, you see Greater Third Ward, and you can see where we have the opportunity to think about TODs. So TODs basically occur at station locations. So again, for us, it's going to be Elgin. By the time we get to the universities, there's a little potential, but not a lot, because the light purple area is the University of Houston, and so we're not going to have a lot of opportunity there. But as we move across, and then go essentially down Martin Luther King to the station at OST, and then to the station at Palm Center. So if you look at our concentrations of African American populations and where our opportunities are vis-a-vis station locations, our greatest potential is probably going to be Palm Center, and to a lesser degree, the intersection of Martin Luther King and OST. The other point I'll add here, though, too, is that the east-west line, should Metro be able to build it, would go east-west, and we'll give another opportunity because it'll come straight across this way and go into the Wheeler-Blodgett station. So there will be potentially some other opportunities in the inner Third Ward area for sort of transit-oriented development communities. So we started off by looking at where our potential is and what the proximate areas are where we can think about transit-oriented development. So I want to talk for a second about our threats. You know, what are the risks and things that would keep us from developing these areas in that manner? The first thing is that most housing near transit is expensive. It's majority high-end. And you can see that already. I mean, I'll tell you that I've been interested in this for a decade. And even before the Main Street line was built, I rode around with the developer to try to find a parcel where we could get some moderate income housing near the station at Wheeler and Main. And even then, and this was 3 or 4 years before the rail line was open, even the parcel, you know, it's a triangle that's right under 59, so like you would be living right, essentially, right under the railroad tracks. Even that was not affordable. He came back with the price on that land and said, Carol, we couldn't even put affordable housing there. And that was 3 years before the Main Street line opened. So when we look at the area along Martin Luther King, there are brand new townhouses there. They're already $250,000, and again, the line hasn't opened. So we know that that kind of pressure is going to be coming about the amount of money that it usually takes to live near these desirable communities. So what else do we know? We know from literature that the neighborhood residents often become wealthier, obviously the higher end housing, but the irony is that their vehicle ownership rises. Now why would that happen? If you displace a moderate to low income family that has two cars, you replace it with a high income family that has three cars, then you end up with what we see in the literature. So the opposite of what we're wanting to happen around these rail lines is actually happening if we don't make a positive attempt to try to have a different outcome. The other thing that I want to show you from literature, and this is a brand new article that really won't even be published until January, but I had a chance to be a reviewer for it and I was so interested in it. The Los Angeles Green Line, which was built in 1995, so that brings up another point that a lot of times this transition takes place over decades. It's not something that we're going to see in 2 years. It's going to be a multi-year transition. And if anybody knows Washington, D.C., you know that's the case. You know, they built those rail lines in 1960, and even now you're seeing these huge transit-oriented development communities spring up around, especially at the outer portions of the line in Virginia, but it's happened on the inner portions of the line about a decade ago, which basically, again, is going to be 20 to 30 years sometimes after the line opens. Well, the Los Angeles Green Line, which opened in 1995, studying the area around that line, there was a decrease in the blacks who lived around the Green Line, an increase in whites. And so I think, you know, just again, looking at Atlanta, looking at Washington, D.C., looking around, we're going to have the same potential and that risk of us becoming invisible when it comes to having these priority properties near the rail lines and that Southeast Purple Line. So what are our opportunities? What can we do about it? What next? There are pre-existing attributes that I think put us in a positive position. So like what? Well, we've got a community there already, so we're not going to try to necessarily start with the community where we don't exist and bring people in. We're there. So that's a good, solid, strong point. Secondly, we've got Palm Center, and we've got that history.
Thank you very much. We've heard two very informative presentations on transportation. Now we will transition to the housing part, and our presenter on housing will be Vicki McBride, who is with the who's a housing consultant for the Houston Area Urban League and an adjunct professor of government at Houston Community College and a graduate of our school. And so she will be presenting on housing equity issue. Oh, yeah, her co-author is, co-presenter is Al Henson, who is with the City of Houston and also a graduate of our planning program.
Thank you, Dr. Bullitt. Thank you for this opportunity to be here. We're both graduates of the doctoral program, and we're practitioners, which we're happy we've had the opportunity to be out firsthand dealing with some of the issues. Al and I are going to present together. Al is actually going to do the presentation, but I'm going to come back and talk about more about my involvement with Houston Area Urban League and how the Urban League has been.
This crisis was mostly contained as loss with the savings and loan industry. Foreclosure was high and visible in that period in the African-American neighborhoods. After the 80s and the 1990s, there was the housing boom with the 1990 Cranston-Gonzalez Affordable Housing Act helped push home ownership. And this was a time when first-time home buyers were highly courted. There was a lot of mortgage lending, but the lending criteria was relaxed to promote homeownership along with other tools. Subprime and predatory lending practices had a negative impact on homeownership expansion. Today, we're still trying to recover from the last economic crisis or the housing crisis, also known as, which began in December of 2007 This was caused by bad bank loans, improper credit run-ins, lax regulatory policies, and misguided government incentives. This crisis consumed an enormous sum of financial and housing wealth due to massive job loss, inability for people to pay mortgages, and housing foreclosures. This crisis was not contained like the crisis of 1980s. This spread into other economic sectors. So using that 51% threshold, I'm going to go through looking at the African-American concentration of 51% and more in the Houston area, central area urban, central urban areas. And as I go through them for the census tract, I look at home ownership as at the percentage, and we'll see how it kind of fluctuates over the past 30 years. So in 1980, what you're looking at and what you'll see for the next series of maps are the shaded areas or census tracts that have that 51% of concentration and more. The blue outline areas are the super neighborhoods that we use as defining our neighborhoods today. So I use that as an overlay. And you see that going back and forth after the census tracts. So in 1980, the average percentage of home ownership was 53. As I overlay those neighborhoods, it was 15 to 20 super neighborhoods then that were concentrated. So in 1990, as you can see, I want you to pay attention in the 1980 as well. There's Fourth Ward. It was there in the 1980 slide, but I want to bring attention to it. It's still there in 1990 as a African-American concentrated neighborhood, but you also see that maybe because of job opportunities, maybe some African-American households moved out to the suburban area. You see, and I included Missouri City because it's in one of our super neighborhoods. So although this is Fort Bend County, you can see that there are some African-American concentration starting to occur down there, or build even more down there. And there are the super neighborhood overlays. As I'll come to the end, I'll be using these super neighborhoods. So make sure I looked at the home ownership. Now, one thing I didn't talk about was the average of home ownership percentage dropping to 25% after the economic crisis of the 80s. Now, this is only in African-American neighborhoods. So this data is coming straight from, so we're focusing on trying to make the African-American neighborhoods more visible, so to speak. So 2000, after the housing boom of the 90s, you see the percentage in African-American concentrated areas go up in home ownership to 57% in 2000. Super neighborhood overlays. And in 2010, the concentration of the census tracts, as you see, Missouri City has grown. There's no more Fourth Ward, no more concentration there. And you see that there has been some African and New American census tracts with African American concentration. So, and those are the neighborhoods from 2010. So after all that, these are the neighborhoods listed to the right of the map, the super neighborhoods that had census tracts of African-American concentration for 30 consistent years. So that means from 1980 to 2010, these are the neighborhoods that our research is focusing on that have sustained an African-American concentration for 30 consistent years. Now, some of this data you've seen already. I was so happy to see Dr. Lewis. This data match with mine. City of Houston's population. This is the numbers as it grows over the years 80 to 2010. But I also added for the African American census tracts, those last tracts that I mentioned. This is the population in their tracts. As you see in 1980, it was large. It was at this amount. Then it decreased. Then after the boom, it increased, and then it decreased in 2010. So that kind of matches with the homeowner ownership. There's a correlation going on there. Okay, and here's the numerical change. Now pay attention, if you please pay attention to the red looking in. I'm going to focus on the row of the African-American census tract concentration The change from 1980 to 1990, there was a decrease in 36,000, approximately 36,000. There was an increase between 1990 and 2000, a decrease between 2000 and 2010. Overall, these African-American, only African-American concentrated census tracts lost 12,258 persons or population. So let's identify and talk about the fair housing concerns that exist. So we know subprime and predatory lending was a problem and was prevalent through both of the periods, both of the economic crises, because African American neighborhoods were starving for any financial products in those neighborhoods. There were limited or no financial options. Traditional loans weren't given. There was a such thing called redlining. And subprime lending was a problem because of its impact. According to our dear Dr. McBride, subprime lending is a problem because of its impact on the capacity to build wealth through home ownership. And as we know, home ownership actually stabilizes neighborhoods. So fair housing law. Fair housing has been a national policy that's impacted African American in different ways. During each of the economic crises, it's impacted them differently. Housing affordability has actually decreased in central urban areas. Wow, central urban areas. Using housing cost over household income, you can see this just such a simple ratio. You can see this decrease happening if you were to apply the ratio to anywhere, but more specifically as I talk about the central urban area. Fair housing policies were available during both crises but have been underutilized as a tool. This is a timeline for fair housing. Like someone said earlier, it took action to make a movement. Martin Luther King died, civil rights movement, Fair Housing Act came into play. In the 1950s, there was a lot of racial and class segregation which led to the Fair Housing Act being essential. There are seven protected classes when we're talking about fair housing and discrimination. LGBT is not directly one of the protected classes, but the lesbian, bisexual, lesbian, LGBT, the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender population is a protected class nonetheless, indirectly, but not, it's not, they have rights. They're not a protected class, but they have rights as well, civil rights. In 1920, National Urban League took on a lot of the responsibility of addressing some of the issues of Negroes, Blacks, African Americans. And the Houston Area Urban League has a fair housing center that actually addresses some of those needs as well. Houston Area Urban League is funded by HUD's Fair Housing Initiative Program, and they have been doing this since 1968. And they address some of the issues about what's prohibited, such as refusing to rent, refusing to negotiate, and something that's very invisible that a lot of us don't see is is falsely denying that housing is available for inspection, sale, or rental, highly invisible. In mortgage lending, the Urban League takes in clients that where they have issues where there's a refusal to make mortgage loans, refuses to provide information, and so on. For time constraints, I'm going to keep moving. So HUD provides funding to state and local governments to enforce this fair housing law. Texas has passed their own Fair Housing Act in 1999 that's substantially equivalent to the Fair Housing Act. The city of Houston does not have a substantially equivalent local fair housing ordinance, but they do have a fair housing ordinance, just not equal or equivalent. So all recipients, grant recipients, must affirmatively further fair housing, AFFH. Starting in 2005, Houston, as a grantee, the city of Houston had to do an analysis of impediments that Dr. McBride was actually a part of. And in 2010, they did the second one. They completed their second one. So the 2010 AI failed to identify and address patterns of segregation based on race and national origin. Now, what HUD has started doing is saying, you know what, we can't let this go on any further. Let's pay attention because there's a lack of data. We need these protected classes to be represented well, maybe with regional data, quantitative data, more quantitative data, more qualitative data, not just census data maybe. So according to this new proposed home rule, the analysis of pediments may not be good enough. So there's a new proposed home rule. This AFFH rule proposes to replace the existing requirements to aid HUD program participants in improving access to opportunity and to provide local governments with more tools. They need more planning, they need more community input and things of this nature. So the Houston Area Urban League, they have a division of housing. They have education, workforce development and training, health initiatives, and they do deal with housing. Now they have some very good data that they've been taking in. They use online data management and Counselor Max as their data collection systems. Great data. This could probably be some of the data that HUD might possibly be talking about. So using the 2010 tracks, not the 14, 30-year sustained African-American neighborhoods, but this represents the 2010 census tracts that had the 51% and more concentration of African-Americans. And the dots represent the Houston Area Urban League's data. So 9% of all this, the clientele is in African-American neighborhoods. 9% of the clients are in the African-American, of all the clients, and 26% of African-Americans are in the African-American neighborhoods. So this is a spatial distribution of the clients that the Urban League is taking in. Great data, and it's the kind of data that maybe, again, possibly, this is what HUD may be referring to, more qualitative data and things of this nature. So closing out some of the preliminary results, centralized African American census tracts remain segregated kind of consistently, kind of the same pattern throughout 30 years. There could be many factors why. Somebody mentioned this, I think Dr. Lewis mentioned one of the reasons earlier. There are a lot of service jobs that was mentioned earlier as well. But fair housing laws have not made much progress. HUD's making strong attempts to AFFH. You'll hear it called that a lot in the future. And they're making a halt. Houston Area Urban League has this data, and we do have more intentions in going more into the data case by case, possibly to figure out what these issues actually are, how many are foreclosures, and to actually disseminate and aggregate what they actually are. So I'll just close that out right there. Thank you.
I'm not going to take much time. Thank you, Al. Because I know it's time to stop, but the main thing is that census data used every 10 years from 2010 to 2020 is just not adequate anymore. The world changes too fast. So organizations like Houston Area Urban League, who's frontline, who's actually collecting data, is going to be more of a primary source because the world changes and they're frontline right there day to day in being able to see the world change. We just need to put it in a format that is conducive to ways that we can make change and do analysis in an appropriate way. But there's got to be more of a marriage and a partnership between academia and community-based organizations. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Our next panelist and final panelist for this session is Professor Susan Rogers, who is an assistant professor at University of Houston and director of the Community Design Resource Center and the School of Architecture at U of H. Professor Rogers.
First, I want to thank Dr. Bullard and the team that's behind him today for a tremendous conference. It's been a true pleasure to be here all day. I hope that I can keep everybody awake. It's been, thank you very much. Oh, awesome. Great. I'm Susan. Design Resource Center at the University of Houston and our College of Architecture. And With the exception of the Fourth Ward, we have worked in partnership with folks in all the neighborhoods I'm going to talk about today. I just want to make sure everybody understands that. We're interested in collaboration and partnership, so it was a perfect kind of segue from Dr. McBride. Our work is place-based. In other words, we're very much interested in what's happening in a place and what are the policies, the demographic transformations, the ideologies that are shaping our cities in Houston and elsewhere. And so today I wanted to talk about historic African American neighborhoods in Houston, but I wanted to talk about it through a lens of place and talk about fundamentally what's happening in cities across the country, not just in Houston, is this kind of turning inside out. People without economic resources are being pushed to the periphery, while people who are wealthy are congregating in the core. And one of the things that is happening with that is a dispersion, if you will, of even our political power, I think, as was discussed earlier. And so you'll see many of the same things you've kind of seen earlier, but hopefully through a little bit different lens. I also, is Glenn still here, who is with Dr. Fagan? I have to make sure that I keep your perspective of making sure that I'm being very honest about the lens that I'm looking through, looking at things through, because I think it's really important. And so I want to start by just reinforcing the fact that Houston is not equal. We all know that. This is a map of median household income above and below, and the outlined areas are the nine historic African-American neighborhoods that I'm looking at. The map on the right is, on the left is median household income. The map in the middle is educational attainment, and then rates of overweight and obesity, which are directly related to our health and chronic disease. We've talked about food deserts. I'm sorry, these are a little washed out. With the exception of Fifth Ward and Sunnyside, none of the nine neighborhoods have a grocery store, and I mean a major grocery store. And the grocery store in Fifth Ward, the Lyons Supermarket, a gallon of milk costs about $5. And if you go a little bit further down the road to Fiesta, it's $3.79. And so even sometimes when there is a grocery store, the quality of the products and the prices of the products are really not proper, not suitable for neighborhoods. But I also was interested in this issue of education. Education is such, Stephen Kleinberg reinforced that over and over, but the relationship of education to economics is extremely tight. Somebody with a high school diploma will make half of what somebody with a bachelor's degree will make every year. It's about $35,000 to $78,000. And so an education is a big indicator of our economic kind of opportunity, which of course shapes our opportunity of where we live, the quality of the neighborhoods that we live in, the quality of the food, the transit accessibility, so on and so forth. This is a map of the 20 magnet schools. Well, it's actually, I only mapped the high schools and the middle schools that are being closed in Houston. If you look at this map, you can see the magnet programs that are being eliminated in Houston are located in either African American or Hispanic neighborhoods. Sunnyside's been particularly hard hit. They've lost their magnet program in both Worthing High School and the middle school there. And I think that this is an issue that we need to think about, because I think the quality of the education in our neighborhoods has got to matter to us all. And so I'm not going to talk about this much. This is just a map of parks and open spaces, tax delinquent property, and vacant land in relationship to the nine neighborhoods. And so I want to start by talking about the historic wards. And the reason I want to start here is because I think that particularly the Fourth Ward has taught us a lesson about what it means to see history completely erased. And I think that the risk is that this is now happening in Third Ward and Fifth Ward. If you look at the amount of demolitions that are happening in both these neighborhoods, they're substantial. The vacant land is substantial. The amount of ownership in all these neighborhoods is very low, and so there's not a lot of kind of control over what's happening. And so I just hear some historical aerials of the Fourth Ward, starting in 1944 through 2013, the construction of I-45. You can see in 1944 it's completely built out. There's a house on every single lot. By 2002, most of that is gone, and by 2013, basically we're on the other side of the erasure, if you know what I mean, meaning that it's all new development. And I have been in Houston on and off since 1987. And so I've been capturing some of the changes that have occurred in our landscape. This was an elderly man who ran a barbecue joint right off of Taft Street in the Fourth Ward. It was called the OK Corral. I don't know if anybody ever went, but it was a pretty amazing place. He's gone now. But this photograph, this kind of time-lapse photograph, if you will, of a street church that's also located off of Taft in the Fourth Ward, in its transformation from a street church to townhouses over time as the neighborhood was erased. And so the reason why I wanted to talk about the historic wards is because it is my fear that Third Ward and Fifth Ward, if something is not done, are going to experience the same fate. I don't know what it means. I don't know if it means organizing. I don't know if it means trying to develop new policies, if it means really trying to get this information out there and people to understand it. But in the Third Ward, 76% of the population rent, meaning they have no power or control over what's happening to the land. And in Fifth Ward, it's 62%. And I think that this is the renter population, because we have no policies in Houston that protect renters from, basically a landlord can give you 30 days. The other thing I want to talk about, though, in relationship to this, is that a recent study by Harvard, actually, I feel like I'm echoing, a recent study by Harvard just found that 20% of all single-family homes that have been purchased in the United States, particularly over the last 5 years, have been purchased by investors, and they're being turned over into the rental market. And so we're going to look a little bit at how homeownership has changed in the Black community in Houston over time. But this, I think, is cause for alarm, because if you projected this trend into the future, that means we all become part of the renter class, and the 1% own all the property. And so here's the Third Ward over time, again from 1944 to 2013, and the changes that have occurred. The Third Ward, it's happening so slowly, it's almost like you can't see it. And it only, if you look at the historical aerials, though, you start getting a picture of just exactly what already has been lost in that neighborhood, and it's a travesty. And so here's the map on the left is construction and demolition permits in 2012, and then the map on the right is the property that was owned by the Midtown TERS in 2009. It's my understanding that that's been doubled and is intended to be being held for affordable housing. I'd like to see some of that housing get in on the ground. And then the change in the Third Ward's population over time, which is 60% of its peak in 1960 at 34,000. The light rail is putting a lot of pressure. Houston is a city of speculation, meaning speculation runs this town. When the Main Street line was being built, as Dr. Lewis pointed out, the land had already gone up just on promise that it was going to be there. Harrisburg, the property on Harrisburg has been bought up for 10 years. And so, what happens, though, with speculation is that it leaves nothing in the wake
while we wait for something new to happen. And that's not really kind of how we want to build our neighborhoods. But I also just noticed that the Houston Housing Authority applied for a Choice Neighborhood Program to redevelop CUNY homes at the very moment that living in CUNY homes probably means, which is right here, which probably means that you have better access to jobs, you'll have new development come your way, and so the neighborhood, in other words, there would be more opportunities for work and accessibility to work elsewhere. That worries me. We've talked about food deserts a lot. I'm not going to say anything except for Jane, who lives in Montrose, has 6 grocery stores within 1 mile. I'm just saying. And so here's a figure ground image of Fifth Ward from the 1970s and to 2010. You can see what's lost, right? I mean, it's stark. And here's an image of Lyons Avenue from a recent AIA RUDAT study at the same place, looking down the street. One on the left looking down the Lyons Avenue today. Yeah, one on the right looking at Lyons Avenue in 1956, I believe it is. 11% of all land has changed hands in the Fifth Ward between 2009 and 2011, and the demographics are changing. The neighborhood, the Hispanic and Latino population, the African-American population are converging at about 50%. About 11% decline in population over the last 10 years in the Fifth Ward. About 437 acres of land are vacant today. So 437 acres of land vacant. I just kind of want to put this in perspective. That means that you could build about 4,000 houses, which could be home to about 12,000 people, give or take. Oops, sorry. So I'm going to run out of time. Can I get an update? Because I'm going to might zoom through this. Thank you very much. And so because each of these neighborhoods are so unique and so different, I don't want to do them injustice by kind of zooming over them. Trinity Houston Gardens was originally created as part of the urban resettlement program that took people off of people who were living in poverty off of farms, resettling them into cities. OST South Union has a completely different history of change kind of over time, and Independence Heights, for those of you who don't know, was the first city in the state of Texas established by and for African Americans. And its history is so incredibly important and as part of kind of the bigger Houston history. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about Independence Heights so I don't run out of time. Independence Heights, because of its location directly north of the Heights, is experiencing substantial pressure for gentrification. The kind of whole proximity, like if you're close to a neighborhood that's gentrified, right? Neil Smith, an author who writes about gentrification, he would talk about, you know, kind of the pioneers and the language that gentrifiers use, this kind of idea that you kind of go in, it's horrible. It's this kind of language of colonizing, if you will, in some kind of really strange way. But the risk in Independence Heights is that the land is so incredibly affordable and it's so close to things that are doing so well that, in fact, we won't be able to stop any tremendous and kind of massive change in Independence Heights either. OST South Union, you can see, is much more intact than the other neighborhoods that I've been talking about. But one of the things we're seeing in OST South Union that we're also seeing in Sunnyside is a decline in the percent of homeowners in the neighborhood. Again, this reinforces that issue that I was talking about the property being bought by investors and people kind of moving on to other neighborhoods. So homeownership has gone from about 58% in OST South Union in 1990 to about 48% in 2010. And so I'm just going to spend a little time talking about historic black settlements. This is important. It ties back into Joe Fagan's kind of talk this morning about the Jim Crow era in the South, because one of the things that happened in Houston, which I think we have to remember, we have to celebrate, and it has to be part of our history, is that a number of neighborhoods were developed specifically outside of the city limits so as to not have to deal with the regulatory and political and social constraints of being inside the city limits. Acres Homes, Set of Gas, Clinton Park, Sunnyside, there's others, Independence Heights amongst them, particularly in the era of Jim Crow, as separate and distinct neighborhoods outside of the city of Houston. Acres Homes, for example, had its own schools, had its own library, its own transit company that ran for years until the neighborhood was annexed into the city of Houston in 1974 when Acres Homes received public sewer and water services, and I believe that came from your book. Acres Homes is also has been plagued with the largest concentration of unpermitted and permitted landfills in the city of Houston at 36. And so I have 2 minutes, so I'm going to go, sorry. these are just some images of Acres Homes, Set of Gas, Clinton Park, and Sunnyside, just to give a sense of their characteristic. The beauty is that Acres Homes was plotted originally in acre lots so that people could provide for their families. This was an era when the whole kind of like back to the land movement was happening, just so you know. And so the idea that people could actually be self-sufficient was really popular at the time, and Acres Homes is representative of that, as is Trinity Houston Gardens and the resettlement program. Set of Gas and Clinton Park both developed on the northeast side in a different model. My fear about Clinton Park is that those two kind of blank spaces you see on either side of the neighborhood are dredging fields from the Houston Ship Channel. On either side of the neighborhood. You can imagine that that soil is of very good quality. And Clinton Park has also been identified as having some of the worst air quality in the city of Houston, and then Sunnyside, which I'm going to talk about kind of really, really, really quickly. We've been working with Sunnyside for the last year. Is anybody here from Sunnyside? There's so many great community people. Awesome. Anyway, we're so excited about what's happening there. There seems to be a lot of kind of organizing and community-led stuff happening. I hope that will continue. And so I just wanted to, I guess, ground kind of some of the work that we did in a little bit more detail. But again, the same thing, land is changing hands. It's the percent of owners in terms of homeowners in Sunnyside is going down. Dr. Henson mentioned that homeownership stabilizes neighborhoods. There's the question of whether, how can the neighborhood continue to kind of organize and grow and change and fight for the things that they want in that neighborhood if there's a dispersion or if there's a, powers being diluted. In 1990, 60% of residents owned. In 2000, it was 54%. By 2010, it was 46%. In Houston overall, for African Americans, it's 35%. In the U.S., 44%. Home ownership is the largest indicator of wealth for any family in the United States. And that's why it's important, and that's why we've done such horrible things to make sure that people could get it in under all the wrong circumstances. And by that I mean the predatory lending, the kind of stuff that where we got people in a situation where it's going to make it difficult for them to recover. I'm not going to talk about that or that. I'm going to stop here. But I just have to say one more thing. And so one of the things that we're interested in, I'm a designer. I'm interested in how things come together. I'm interested in systemic stuff. And so one of the things I hope this is actually a good end to the conference, and I know we have a discussion, but the idea that all of these things are connected. the kind of our education, our economic opportunity, our accessibility to public spaces, our ability to access healthy, fresh, and affordable food, our safety, our neighborhood stability, and the quality of our environment in terms of lacking any hazards, we have to make in our education, I hope I said that, I think I'm going around, but all these things work together, and we have to find ways to address them all kind of simultaneously and comprehensively. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Panelists, could you come on up for the Q&A part of this discussion? And if you have questions, would you line up at the mic? And while the panelists speakers are coming up, I'd like to just preface my one question that I have by just giving you a look-see at the cover of Invisible Houston. This is a photo of the Fourth Ward that does not exist anymore. And as I flip through the cover and show, this is the Fourth Ward. I hadn't looked in this book for a long time, but these are the chapters. Blacks in the New South, the South's largest black community, it was then and it still is now. Housing occupancy trends and the black neighborhoods, housing the city's poor, persisting barriers of discrimination in housing, environmental quality in Houston's neighborhood, sharing the economic pie, black business development, law enforcement in the black community, the quest for equal rights. Do you think any of this stuff, is it relevant today?
Absolutely.
So, first question, we'll alternate first on this side and then we'll go to that side.
I'd like to ask a question premised on the article in Atlantic Monthly this month, Boomtown, Bustown, if you've seen that or not, but it says that it names cities, of course Houston is named, bust and boom, but most of them also have opportunity. And I'm so excited about what's happened today and Dr. Bullard and all of the great work that everybody does here. That last speaker, a while. Awesome. Here's what I want to ask. I worked with Martin Luther King for 10 years, okay? We did not continue the work that we were doing with him. He said in 61, we've got to get back to fix our communities. We never got to because he had too many crises to face. But here's what I want to ask. Everywhere in America we've named stuff for him, it's broken down and decrepit. Everywhere in America. I wonder if maybe in Houston, somewhere along the Martin Luther King Boulevard piece, but more than that, I'm talking about the spirit of this now, how can we take this awesome talent you've got here and this extraordinary talent, because I think we are spending so much time on deconstruction, I want to see us get to reconstruction, and I wonder if this couldn't be the beginning of a new third reconstruction master plan. I think you've set the stage for it, and I'd like to plead that that might be an outcome. I don't know if anybody has a comment or not. I'd appreciate it.
I think Dr. Bullard is the catalyst, so he's brought us all together. This is a starting point. Let's let Dr. Bullard say what his vision is for all of us collectively, the audience and the experts up here, to move forward.
Well, I think that's part of the wrap-up next steps. I'd like to do that.
Okay.
Well, I'd like to do that after we have had all the Q&A and then we go to how we want to move forward and next step. This is more than just the conference and the summit. I'm an action-oriented person.
Right.
Sorry. So anybody who want to...
Well, I would say that I think that's clearly where we need to go. And I try to end with opportunities, and I actually think that Dr. Rodriguez in the panel before kind of did the same thing, ended with, you know, sort of next steps. So I think that at least we have a platform to do exactly what you say, and I think you're right, the time is now.
Yeah. Okay, on this side.
Okay. Good afternoon. Thank you, panelists, for your presentations this afternoon. My question is in relation to Houston's relationship with land and sort of the speculative nature that investors have sort of acquired property in the city. I'm wondering if there are any efforts going on to sort of recapture land back into a more collective or public domain, because it seems like there's a lot of, you know, outside investment, local investment in private sort of individual ownership. And I'm wondering if there are any opportunities at the city level or with nonprofit groups or individuals to sort of come together and put land more into a collective bank. Maybe it's a land bank or something like that, with help from the redevelopment authority through tax lien properties or through other properties that are held in ownership by public agencies.
The closest, quickest answer I can give you is Houston Hope Neighborhoods. They actually have, they land bank the city of Houston land banks. It's with LARA, the Land Assemblage Redevelopment Authority. Another resource would be Midtown Redevelopment Authority. They have land, but yeah, you got to go ready to do something with the Midtown Redevelopment. Their criteria is a little different from the city of Houston, but if you go do some research, you'll see, if you can see how many lots are available. They actually they sell the lots for private development, but the land is banked within the boundaries of Houston Hope areas.
I'm like the Steven Kleinberg position. I would just add that one of the things we could also look into is having taxation policies that deter people from speculating, which would keep land values at a more appropriate level for our city, across the city. There's no tax penalty for speculating on property. And so, in other words, someone's still paying the appraised value, even if the appraised value is $25,000 and they're asking for $200,000. Does that make sense? They're paying on the $25,000. If we could change that, then we could change probably speculation. So,
okay, let's on this side.
Okay, and the next steps, I think we need to have a day-long summit on housing, really, because I think these issues are very complex. I'm the vice chair of the Houston Housing Authority. So, Dr. Rogers, I'm concerned about, you're concerned about the Choice Grant, which is a $500,000 grant that allows us to talk about really developing Northern Third Ward. So that, to me, is a plus and not a negative. And then I want to say the tension is, to me right now, it's really about this issue about home ownership and even this fair housing, because the Fair Housing Act is being used against developing and revitalizing urban communities, because they're telling us, as the Houston Housing Authority, $180 million agency, we can't invest in Sunnyside and South Park. It is too minority. It's too many black people there. It's too many Latino people there. You can only go where the neighborhood is being gentrified. Those are the words they use to us exactly.
High opportunity.
And so, you know, that is a problem and a tension.
New word, right? Yeah.
And so we've got to really talk about that issue. But I want to say Northern Third Ward, 60% of Northern Third Ward is owned by churches. This is not an over and done with deal. It will be if we continue to see it like that, but 60% is still up for grabs. Churches have it. And so my question is, we talk about home ownership, and in Sunnyside and South Park, my grandparents' home is worth less than $25,000. They bought that home in 1962. $25,000. So this idea that home ownership is the parachute to mobility does not work for African Americans. And so the tension for me really is about multifamily housing and the strong resistance we constantly get in minority communities about using multifamily housing as a way to create income diversity in neighborhoods, because many people cannot afford to buy homes and they cannot afford to maintain those homes. So why are we still not focusing on rental properties as a way to continue to diversify the economics in a neighborhood instead of focusing so solely on single-family home ownership?
And I have to respond to that because you're absolutely right. And thank you for modifying my comments about the Third Ward. We need people like you, though, fighting for the Third Ward, because otherwise there's not the right people at the table. You know what I mean? I mean, it's happened everywhere, you know. And where I heard it was actually from a developer who was sitting on the Houston Housing Authority Board, which I thought was weird to begin with. But I mean, just in terms of, it felt to me like the people driving the Houston Housing Authority should be empathetic about the need for housing for people who can't afford it otherwise. And so I know, I'm glad that you are. This particular person was not, and I'm assuming he's gone. So, you know, I agree with you 100%, and I think multifamily housing is definitely an option. And I think even new models, we've been working with the pastor up in the Fifth Ward, and churches own property all over historic black neighborhoods in Houston, and he's interested in a new model for example, young people coming out of the foster care system, and how do we provide housing for them that can give them the support that they need to kind of, so I think we need to get together, I think we need to talk about housing, I think we have to talk about the new models, how Houston Hope, Community Land Trust, and other things can come together to build better housing in all the neighborhoods, and definitely
and
this.
Let's not say homeowners are the only ones that care about
it. It's not.
I don't own a home, but I care.
I rented until I was well into my 40s, so I understand. Absolutely.
I'd like to add, once again, I can't say enough about community-based organizations like Houston Area Urban League. You need to come in and let's talk about what is the vision for your community. Houston Area Urban League has been a partner to the black communities and has always been there. Housing is on the forefront. We've created a CHOTA. We have experts and professionals working with us with a mission, yes, to make money. But there's also that other concern that is even more prevalent, is preserving our communities and partnering with organizations and people with concerns like you have. If we don't have the answers, we can certainly work with you to help find some of the developers and other partners that can help make sense and a money opportunity, because it's all going to boil down to that. For it'll be a win-win situation for the community as well as the development process.
Okay, we have the question on. Okay, can you the mic? Can you speak up or?
Yeah, I can speak up. Two things. One, Dr. Bullock, I'd like to see you put together a think tank. Sylvester Turner did one for the state legislature. A&M put up the money. And we wanted it here in Houston. A&M said no, it's going to where they want it, so it's either in Austin or A&M, wherever it is. But we would need one here, and I'm going to tell you why. I heard two people here talk about jobs today. You can't do nothing unless people in the communities have an economic base, okay? Bob Lanier came in. He sat out one day and talked to me for 5 hours. He said, Bennett, I'm going to do neighborhood standards. I said, what the hell is that? He said, I'm going to pick every neighborhood that backs up to downtown. I'm going to do new infrastructure, sidewalks, sewer, wastewater, everything. You know why he did that? So his white developer friends could come in and build all these townhouses you see going up around. We didn't take advantage of that. We didn't have communications. Secondly, in doing that, that left us out. All these plans you talk about along the rail, the opportunities, we missed out on that. Cities are defined as two things. They maximize communication and shorten distance travel time. Houston does none of that. It's totally dysfunctional. Okay? And we sit here and we talk about these things, but unless we have money, Metro, you give this contract to Rapid Transit. That's four white companies that came together after all the graft and the whatever went on. They give it to four white companies. They put in a bid, okay? They determine that they need 13 inches of concrete, okay? In the process, they went and changed the rules and said, hey, we only need 10 inches. They didn't tell Metro. They saved $300 million. They stole $300 million. Nobody's talking about that, okay? We were totally left out. We don't have one black-owned
concrete company. Think about it. Every damn thing we exist in has concrete. Not one concrete company. Okay? So you talk about CUNY Homes. TSU had the opportunity to partner with the Texas Department of Corrections and take out those inmates that are being released back into society, house them over there. Department of Sociology, our education department, could work with those families and get the money they spend on reincarceration. That would lower the rates. It would be worth it to the state to pay TSU to say, hey, make these people viable again. Yeah, they're going to do away with CUNY Homes because we haven't taken advantage of it. It's very simple. Take Bob Lanier when he was in office. Go back and look at the friends of him that got grants to build houses and didn't build one stick of a house. Not one.
Okay, we need to wrap it up. Yes, sir.
I know. What I'm saying is that we really need a think tank here.
Okay, I hear you.
The partnership is working for the white people, as y'all said earlier. We don't have a think tank. Everything you said here today has been reactionary. Okay, not anticipatory, but reactionary. And so unless we have a think tank where you can take some of these people that you brought in here today and create a brain trust and come up with ideas that you can employ and make happen.
Okay, could we modify that to be a think / act tank?
Yeah.
Okay, could we, thank you. Could we get the question over here?
Well, in the vein of a proactive approach, one of the things that since we've talked about, some of the panelists talked about how Fourth Ward has kind of been a lesson for maybe Third Ward and Fifth Ward, still historically black areas that are still predominantly black. When I wrote a paper about gentrification about Third Ward several years back, and your book was very helpful in that, so thank you very much, Dr. Bullard. But one of the things that I noticed is that a lot of these neighborhoods, since there's no zoning, they have a lot of de-restrictions. So, but most people, since we said was like 76% of our renters, most people, of course, don't have a clue. So my question, I have two parts. So the first thing is, one of the things I thought maybe de-restrictions, paying attention to de-restrictions and actually enforcing them so you don't have a $2 million monstrosity pop up right next door to the shotgun shack about helping slow down the gentrification process and the developers that are coming in and just taking parcels of land and turning them into something that nobody can afford to live next to. And also, I wanted to ask about far as the rail on the side that we know the rail is coming and it's going to expand and it's going to expand more. The question is, how do we make sure that the rail doesn't do quite what the freeways did to the Third Ward and splinter them off in a fashion where a lot of people are displaced and moved out of the neighborhood as well? So to the panelists that can answer.
Start off with your first comment. I happen to be chair of the Planning Commission under Mayor White, so I know a little bit about the deed restrictions and setbacks. And so basically that is a potential tool to protect blocks. The issue is that the entire block has to sign to get a deed restriction. If it's already deed restricted, it's fine. But if you go into a lot of these neighborhoods where the pressure is on and they're not already deed restricted, then what they can do, because it's really hard to get deed restrictions if you don't already have them, but it's easier to get setbacks. And what a setback will do is, you remember, most of these, you know, sort of huge structures are built almost street face, and in order to get whatever they're trying to get, 3,500 or 4,000 square feet, they really need to use the entire property line. So if a neighborhood can go in, a whole side of a block can do it and get setbacks. So basically what it does is it makes that property unattractive to someone who wants to build one of those huge, you know, kind of structures.
The
setbacks are within Chapter 42.
Yeah,
they're within Chapter 42. So that's a way to do that. But on the second part, I think the answer about how to keep the rail from acting as a wall, I think that the way it's constructed already sort of prohibits that in a sense because it's at grade. I think the question would be a lot more prevalent if it were an elevated structure like I-45 and you had to cross under it. So it's just like the one on Main Street. It doesn't block anything visually. You can see across it. You shouldn't, but people can actually cross it. So it really won't serve as the same kind of barrier. And I think that there are a lot of things that have to happen, as I mentioned, in order to keep properties and sort of the psychological barrier from happening, with people not feeling as if they can necessarily access it, or you know, with the change in property either values and or use near the rail. And I think that's the biggest threat. And again, the only way to do that is with a lot of community pressure and a lot of community action.
We're gonna limit the last three questions to the three people that are standing on this side.
Thank you, everybody. It was incredible. I've been honored to be here today. I happen to be the one guy who probably doesn't one of the few people who doesn't live in Houston here. But it's been wonderful to get to work down here some. And transit-oriented development, I saw them tear down my mother's working-class apartment complex in the Dallas area and build up high expensive condos. Where I live in Southeast Austin, you know, they're tearing down neighborhoods, working class neighborhoods, and building up these expensive condos. It's happening everywhere. You know, what I'm wondering, there's two things here about this, about the transit orientation and gentrification in general. The first question I have is, with in terms of bang for our buck, shouldn't we be looking at buses as opposed to trains, being able to solve the problems of transit, getting people where they need to be, saving them on transportation costs without creating this, you know, kind of bait for gentrification? Should we maybe be looking at the buses? And then the second question, a bigger picture question here, is if the problem is that the land in a place like Independence Heights is really attractive to investors because it's cheap, shouldn't we maybe be organizing or looking at creating an alternative to a market-based economy?
Sounds pretty simple.
Yeah. I would say this. I do believe that the market will continue to fail people, as it does, as it has, since we've become dependent on it to value everything in our lives. And so I agree with that point, just so you know.
Yes.
On the transit question, the answer is, in theory, you actually want to build rail where you have more people than can be carried in a single bus. All right, so if you're having rail constructed where you don't have, in all honesty, hundreds of people boarding, then you probably didn't need it. So transit professionals will tell you that it's hugely important for the bus system and the rail system to work together, because you can't have a good rail system without a good bus system. And so you need it. So basically, for instance, on the 7 miles that Metro currently has, that line is carrying 24,000 people a day. I mean, I can't quickly calculate how many buses it would take to carry 24,000 people a day down Main Street. So that's what's going on. In theory, you replace, when you would have bus after bus after bus after bus after bus to try to carry those people, that's when you want to convert to rail. And the cost of public transit is that 80% of the dollar goes to pay the driver. So if the driver is only carrying 40 people, or if you can get him to carry 1,000, that's what you want to do. So that's when you want to transition to rail. So, but you don't want it if you don't need it. So, you know, the point is valid in that sense.
Going back to that part of your question where you mentioned that why not use more buses instead of tearing down houses and building in rails, one of the, you know, solutions to that is that we need to have, again, you know, a culture of using public transit. So this is a state where people, you know, take pride in car ownership, and the state spends more money on infrastructure development rather than on public transit. And as I showed you, you know, the state just invests in the operating cost, and compared to other states where there are the large metropolitan centers. And so, you know, we need to change that culture. And also, you know, we live in a society where we kind of catch up with things when there is endorsement by celebrities. For example, you know, like in New York, the past mayor Bloomberg, he used to ride the public transit. Even Joe Biden used to take the public transit to work. So if we have a state culture, and also, you know, our political celebrities as such endorse the use of public transit, if the mayor takes the public transit to work along with his other, with her cabinet advisors, etc., I think we will see, you know, and again, and being endorsed by other celebrities in the area, I think there'll be greater use of public transit, and it will be more fashionable and more, you know, like environmental friendly, etc., to ride public transit and make greater use of buses.
Okay, thank you.
My question is for Dr. Lewis. You don't have time to answer it, but I'll tell you what it is. During your remarks, you alluded to the fact that there were techniques that were used to, in some way, negate the negative impact of transit on the neighborhood. The Southeast Line will travel through the eastern border of my community, and there is a lot of concern about the impact of that transit line on the neighborhood. So I just want to get from you those sources I can review to identify the strategies that might help my community.
What I was actually referring to was strategies that cities and entities use to keep cost of housing down. But So it's kind of a little different thing. But I'll talk to you later about why the neighborhood doesn't really need to be nervous at all. And I'll tell you, the short version of it is that if you look around the country where rail has been built, here's the sort of thread, that if the rail is built in an area that where property values are decreasing, the rail doesn't stop the decrease. But if you build rail in an area where the property values are stable to increasing slightly, the presence of the rail causes those values to increase even more. If you build rail near a neighborhood where the property values have been very high, the presence of the rail causes those property values to go through the roof in terms of value. So that's the answer. So, and I know your area. So your area has not been decreasing. There's a lot of new construction there. And so there's no reason for your neighbors to be worried. The only thing that your neighborhood could probably complain about is having to circuitously get out of the neighborhood. You know, it is going to affect your coming in and going out. You can't just come out on any street and turn anymore. But in terms of the values, there should not be a negative effect on the values.
Thank you.
Okay, and the last, thank you very much. And the last question, yes.
Thank you all for your work and your research. Dr. Lewis, I really appreciate the shout out to Washington, D.C., because I lived there for 4 years before I moved to Texas. And I worked on fair housing and anti-displacement campaigns while I was there. So drawing a lot of parallels between what we're hearing today and the information that y'all are presenting today. In D.C., we have really ridiculous zoning laws as well, one being the height limit ordinance, which doesn't allow buildings to be, you know, built above a specific height. I think it's like the height of the Capitol or something like that, arbitrary. I think a lot of housing rights and smart growth advocates would say that that's like an enemy of density, right? And that a logical conclusion would be to build more high rises in these neighborhoods where we need more housing, and that in the end, we would get a lot of these developers to agree to have some of these high-rises be mixed income. But a lot of folks in the communities that we would work with would say, no, we don't want to live in these high-rises that actually don't look like anything like these communities that we've lived in and our families have lived in for decades. And so I'm interested in to hear from you all if that's a concern here in Houston, and how thoughts on strategies for developing housing policies that are just and equitable and also human scaled.
We don't have any housing policy
that's
in the city of Houston.
And number one problem.
And I want to say that's the reason why we have this great inversion, this kind of turning inside out. Rents for one bedroom apartment in Greens Point is $500. It's incredibly affordable, and you can't get rent for that inside the Loop. At least not in an apartment that's been built in the last 20 years. And so you have to mandate the requirements for affordable housing if you actually want people to build it. Because otherwise, without public money and subsidies, nobody's going to do it.
I pass it along to Vicki. I was going to say the issue is that the property values, some of which are inflated, are going to drive the cost of the housing. I don't think you're going to see anything in human scale in Houston ever, honestly, because I think the value of the land is too high. And so just like that little piece of property that's under the freeway, they couldn't even do anything affordable, let alone human scale there, because once they buy the property, they have to build so many units to recoup their money. So look, when I went out to the Woodlands and saw a four-story apartment crammed like this, I knew it's over in Houston for human scale, you know.
A city the size of Houston without zoning, without, you know, only operates through deed restriction, with complex neighborhoods, cultures, and becoming more and more like the big cities of the world, is very difficult for us to do a good job with housing unless we create a housing policy ordinance. Please push your council members to support that idea so we can do many other things that we need to do in this room.
It's such a thing, and is somebody working on such a thing, Dr. McBride?
They have in the past, haven't they, Paulette?
We did try.
We tried.
Thank you.
That's why I'm just going to end up being dinner.
Yeah. Thank you, panelists. We have 15 minutes, and I think the 15 minutes, what we'll take in terms of the wrap-up. My takeaway from this today's summit, and I've taken notes, and we have individuals of our staff taking notes about what has happened today. I think the question that I'd like to ask is, what should be the role of the Barbara Jordan Mickey Leland School of Public Affairs? We are the policy school at this university. What is the role of this school in terms of convening, facilitating, researching, doing policy work, developing, creating this think tank, act tank, do tank to take the lead in addressing equity issues? Whether it ranging from health equity, housing equity, environmental equity, environmental justice, taking all these issues and having our various programs that are in our school, and I can speak for this school because I am the dean. We have a Department of Urban Planning, Environmental Policy, which is a master's PhD program. We have faculty and we have students working on these issues. Across the street is University of Houston, and Professor Rogers and her colleagues have expressed an interest in working on a collaborative way. We have colleagues at Rice University with the Shell Center, with the Kinder Institute. We have individuals at University of Texas in Austin, Texas A&M University. We have colleagues and universities that have resources to work with communities. So the communities are not out there by themselves. And I think the idea of revisiting these issues and crystallizing the findings and making them known and visible and get them in the hands of policymakers and organizations and to support groups, organizations like the Houston Area Urban League, bring together those entities that have land ownership, such as churches, and to bring together homeowners that are still in neighborhoods that they still have control over their properties, and to create and to form coalitions and partners with those entities that are trying to develop new models of urban sustainability and neighborhood stabilization, so that we connect those different pieces together, whereas it appears that there's a bit of, there's some things going on, a lot of things going on, but it doesn't seem to be connected in a very, in a very coherent way. And I think there probably needs to be some mechanism that could, or some entity that could convene and continue to create this communication, this facilitation. You know, I lived, when I left Houston, I went to Los Angeles, and I lived through a lot of the issues. I remember when they were fighting over the lawsuit over by the bus riders union over the buses funds being robbed by the rail line, and I remember the lawsuit that was won in terms of the Title VI civil rights lawsuit, and you know, 95% of the bus riders were people of color, and they robbed the buses to build the light rail, and you know, 95% of the folks were people of color looking at the light rail. So now I'm glad the green, you know, the rail didn't even go to the airport. So it's like, well, who's riding it? I just left Atlanta 2 years ago. I understand the impact of transit-oriented development and this whole idea of building a light rail line. They call it the belt line. It's like it goes in a semicircle. It's like a gerbil line. And it won't work unless there's a strong martyr. And so having lived in Houston and then moved to LA and Atlanta and back to Houston, I think there are some issues that I think we can tease out and identify who the likely partners are and create some collaboratives. The day is long gone that one entity will carry the weight of all of it. So when you talk about a think tank, I think it could be spearheaded and led from this campus, and it should be. Yeah. If we talk about these historic wards, I mean, we talk about the loss of Fourth Ward. You know, when I wrote in Invisible Houston, I was talking about, as Allen Parkway Village goes, so goes the Fourth Ward. When they tore down Allen Parkway Village, I mean, that was a sign that, hey, the Fourth Ward is next. And so we talk about Third Ward. We're sitting in the middle of Third Ward. I mean, this university and University of Houston, I mean, the fact is that we have the brain power and the resources in terms of our collective will to stem some of the bleeding that's occurring. We know that Houston is ruled by what's called unrestrained capitalism. You got the money, you can almost do anything. But I think the collective, when you look at the politics and you look at the fact that on the ground, if the most organized communities can make a difference in terms of what happens in the future. The future is not set. It is not set. It is not a done deal. We have to understand this is not a done deal. And if in fact, if when we leave here today, that, and I will commit, and my staff and the faculty within our school, I want to thank them for working hard to make sure that you got here, and I want to thank you for staying. It's a long day, but I think this is just the first step of a long journey to revisit. Something that I think got left off the table, now we want to put it back on. This should be a priority issue for all of our organizations, non-governmental organizations, our faith-based organizations, neighborhood organizations, civic clubs, to rally around the fact that we want to ensure that this whole concept, Houston being the most ethnic diverse city in the world, that diversity also goes to including economic, social justice, and all those other areas, so that we really become talking, so we really can be held up and get 3 stars and the gold medal for all those areas. So I will commit to making sure that there will be follow-up on this, and right now, I will entertain ideas that you have that we can kind of like tick off and put down as to what you think we can actually do together going forward. And we have 15 minutes. 15 minutes to move this. We know that this is just to be a this will just be kind of like hitting the surface, and that because we all have emails, internet, and we will have a series of convenings after this, and there probably will be some small convening task force that you volunteer, that you self-select what you want to work on, that we can follow up on this. Yes.
I'm Doris Ellis Robinson. I'm president of the Friends of Emancipation Park. I'm owner of the Houston Sun newspaper. But when you made the statement that we just heard, that is the very reason we formed the Friends of Emancipation Park. Saw a vision, we saw what was coming, and we tried to put together a group of volunteers who could stem the tide and make something happen, because we believed that something could happen that could impact this community. And whether you heard about it or not, it's coming. Yeah. And it's been volunteers. Nobody's getting paid. Mm-hmm. Volunteers came together with some ideas and have met consistently since 2007 in the fall. And we broke ground on October 26th for a new Emancipation Park, starting with $33 million. You can do whatever you want to do. You put your time, your resource, and your talents into it. You got to believe that you can do it, and you just keep forging forward and pull in your collaborative partners, and you can make it happen regardless of what other people who cannot see the vision cannot see. You can't make them see it, but you can make yourself continue to drive forward if you want it to happen. And I look forward to collaborating with whatever we decide.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
My name.
Stand up, please.
My name is Renita Thornton. I'm the president of the Vanquish Civic Association, which is actually on the other side of TSU, Washington Terrace Civic Association. And we actually fought Metro from coming through our neighborhood. And right now it's not going to happen, hopefully. And what happens is, as an association, as individuals, we're not taken seriously by the government, by Houston's city council. So it's nothing that we can really do as individuals. We always, they put all the work on us. If we want deed restrictions, or if we want something in our neighborhood, if we don't want developers to come in and take over our neighborhood, we have to work hard to get the neighborhood together to do it. We have no backing with our politicians and with people that we elect in office to get things done. I think you should reach out to the super neighborhoods to form a coalition to address everything. Because everybody's addressing things individually. Like you have people addressing the school system, people addressing having food deserts and not having access to quality food. If we get a coalition together to address everything, because everything goes into a neighborhood. Once your schools go, your neighborhood goes. And people don't move into neighborhoods if they don't have a grocery store. So if you have all the things there to create a whole village of a neighborhood and not just individuals. There are a lot of people in Third Ward that have their own agendas. And I think that's one reason a lot of things don't get done, because everybody has different agendas. But if we can all come together and have one agenda to say, this is what we need to do as a whole. We need more access to education. And we're right here at two universities, and Jack Yates has a big problem.
Yeah.
In between two schools.
Yeah.
Jack Yates should be one of the premier schools in Houston.
Yes. You're right.
It should
yeah.
be.
Absolutely right.
Yeah.
It should be between two universities.
Yes.
So between everybody together, this neighborhood, out of any neighborhood out of the entire country, I feel Third Ward should be able to do it. Because we have two universities in our area. We have the money. We have the medical center. We have downtown. If we can't do it, then I don't think any black neighborhood in America can. And that's one reason I moved into Third Ward. When everybody told me not to in 1996, everybody told me don't move over there. But I chose to move over here, and I've been trying to work. But it's difficult as just a citizen in a developer-driven city.
So, thank you.
We can do it.
Okay, and right here, yes, and then in the back, yeah.
I have a plea. My church designated me to work with the leadership of Detroit, holds a coalition together. You know, Detroit's in bankruptcy.
Yes.
And a lot of cities are headed that way unless we interrupt that trend. Mine is a plea. The talent here that I heard today excites me that we can put together that master plan that can be worked in Johannesburg, it can work in Jacksonville, Mississippi, it can work anywhere on the globe. And mine is a plea. I need help in what I'm trying to do. Whether anybody else does anything or not, I got to do what I got. I'm in the fourth semester at 82. I can't fool around.
Yeah, you value time. I hear you, brother. I hear you, brother. Yes, ma'am.
I would just suggest that there be working groups formed from the participants in today's conference that can meet for an hour and a half or 2 hours, maybe broken down on the topics of the presentation or the panels, and maybe use TNQ as a base to work from.
Okay, thank you. Yes, sir.
Peter Jobs, Texas Campaign for the Environment. Something that we want to start working on, that I want to throw out there for people to listen to. We've had some good meetings already talking about this. A couple folks is waste not, want not. And this is something that other communities have started doing. Just a piece of the puzzle, and want to throw it out there, that zero waste is a philosophy that looks at the waste stream and sees that most of it, a lot of it's recyclable, a lot of it's compostable, that we don't have to be dumping on our communities anymore, that we can be taking this stuff, capturing it, and turning it into good paying jobs. That once we have all those, if we have the materials, like in Austin, they're starting to invite new light industry into town with their materials. Houston is, you know, 3-4 times the size. And there's thousands of jobs, literally thousands of jobs that can be created. So we take this from communities that we are polluting, that we're dumping on, into communities that we are investing in. And it's also, and I'll end on this as saying that, you know, that there's a possibility for a higher order synthesis here, where the communities, or the environmental movement, which has always been seen as this white thing, this middle class thing, connects to these communities of color, to the social justice and civil rights movements, so that we can build power together and build a community and build a movement that will overthrow, that can change the dynamics in a city like Houston. We got to give ourselves reasons why and not reasons why not.
That's right.
And this is just one concrete project that we want to pursue, and we hope that folks here will join with us as they can.
Okay, we're going to have two last questions quickly right here and then right here, and then we're going to wrap up.
I'm a student in the public affairs program here, and as I've been taught in the public affairs program, the first step, or one of the primary steps in implementing public policy is to set the agenda. And I think that based upon this meeting here, that is one of the primary first steps to concretize, organize, and qualify the information and to set the agenda in a form that is highly coherent and articulate, and with emphasis on collecting information and buy-in from the communities that it's going to affect positively. So in terms of setting up an agenda, there are various media sources that can be taken advantage of that we need to put on a particular list to report the things that we're doing, to publish the things that we're doing, and to continue programming around setting that agenda. Once you set that agenda and it becomes institutionalized, you maximize your ability to recruit people, you maximize your ability to put that information out there, educate people, and you'll have buy-in. So I suggest one of the first things that we do out of this tremendous policy summit is to develop a way to set the agenda for all the things that we've talked about here, all of the vast research and resources and organizations that are represented here, the work that you put in. Let's put in work on setting a solid agenda that's comprehensive and push it forward. There's a KPFT over on University of Houston. There's a KTSU here, set the, and that's just an image.
Yeah.
But let's set the agenda. If we truly believe in this policy, then let's translate this policy into programs and institutions That's the only way these things, because these are things about power.
Yes.
The power that we must have as a community to not only resist the practices that have been going on, but to insist on something. Yeah.
Yeah.
So let's set the agenda.
Okay. Yeah, last comment.
The way of moving forward, I do think we should have the workings. I don't think everyone's interested in the same thing, don't have the same level of expertise and the thing that we need to bring all together. I do think we should have the workings. And I think the work groups should have specific policies, recommendations for local government, City of Houston, and then state government, and then national, because those are practical things that we can push in terms of people who are running for public office, but also people who are elected. And also I want to ask all the presenters to please put their PowerPoint presentations online.
We'll have that. Yes. We don't have to ask that. We'll have that.
Okay. I'm asking for a summit on housing. I think housing is critical. It's a critical way in which we can really stem the tide and control development and revitalization. So if we can conquer and deal with housing as a strategy, I think we'll be far along in this process.
Yes, I agree. You know, as I said before, I'm the dean of the School of Public Affairs. We're the policy school, and so if you said you need a housing summit, I mean, it's just a matter of us bringing the right people together and hold a summit and do what we need to do. You know, I'm an activist dean. You know, I've only been a dean for 3 years, and I've been an activist scholar for 30 plus. So, you know, I know about activism more so than dean. But don't tell the president, though.
Yes.
One last point. Yeah.
I wanted to thank you and your team for having the courage to start a conversation that we need to have, not just in this city, but in this country, and to change the models that we've become so dependent on because they no longer. And I don't know that they ever did, but I wanted to thank you for that.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Again, I want to thank my staff and the faculty at the School of Public Affairs. We will consider the summit closed. I do have parking validation for those who may need it.
It's open?
Oh, okay. All right, well, hey. Thank you very much.